2017 Hunter Rouse Hydraulic Engineering Award from the American Society of Civil Engineers, Career Award from the National Science Foundation, and he is the Fellow of the American Physical Society and the American Society of Mechanical Engineers. His research focuses on simulation-based engineering science for fluid mechanics, problems in renewable energy, environmental, biological, and cardiovascular applications. I'm totally confused, but I'm looking forward to the talk to learn really what you're doing. So welcome, we're Thank really you. Excited to have you here.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Helena, for the kind introduction and the invitation. And thank you all. You've been the most gracious host. And I always have a great time when I come to NYU, but especially this visit. And, you know, as Helena mentioned, we have this secret society dean's meetings where we get together and we talk about, it's a dean's therapy session, basically, where we talk about what our faculty are doing to us, what our provosts and so on, and it's what keeps us going. But then through this, we build great friendships and collaborative works, and it's been a real pleasure getting to know Helena through this, and it's been a lot of fun. So what I would like to do here, try perhaps to explain a little bit all these different things and maybe this crazy title of my talk, giving you an overview of the work that I've been doing over the last 10, 12 years. Mostly this is work I did at the University of Minnesota when I could still do extensive research. Now as dean at Stony Brook, I still stay involved in research, but obviously not at the scale that I was able to do before. And of course, this has been possible through the contributions of a number of great students and postdocs and other collaborators that I had the privilege and the honor to work through the years, and I'll highlight them through different parts of my talk. But my work has been focusing on computational modeling, using computer simulation to study a broad range of fluid problems. And of course, because as you become faculty and you try to build your career, if you have powerful computational tools, you can be very versatile because flow problems, fluid mechanics problems, are very ubiquitous and appear in different settings. And the basic underlying principles appear in all this. So there are a lot of cool, interesting problems to solve in different settings. So that's the title of jumping fish, heart valves, river flooding, and wind energy. Because what is the common denominator in all this, of course, is that there is a fluid that interacts with something, right? Whether it is water with fish, or blood with heart valves, or wind, atmospheric wind with wind energy, and so on. So I'll take you through a little bit of a journey of my career over the last 10 years, and starting from a little bit of my earlier work from about 10 years ago, getting more to the recent things that I've been doing. I'm not going to get too deep in the numerics. I'm going to focus primarily on trying to demonstrate to you the power of computational science today, right? And show you the types of cool things that one can do. So, as I said, fluid mechanics is ubiquitous and across a range of problems and transport problems, right? Flow and transport problems, and occur across a range of scales, but also in different application areas. And specifically, I have been quite fascinated about fluid mechanics since a very young age, long ago, I was an undergraduate in Greece. But the types of problems that fascinated me are problems that are really complicated, right? Involving very complex flows. Like, for instance, how do you harness renewable energy from wind, tides, and waves? Of course, these types of problems involve the interaction of fluid, whether it is wind or water, with devices. In order to optimize the energy extraction really here, you have to understand the interaction of the fluid flow with the energy extracting devices, right? And these things are so complicated that, and especially we're talking about building wind farms and so on, that you have to rely on simulation to be able to create kind of virtual worlds that you can study and do engineering optimization and design. Another area is so that's where actually my aerospace engineering background kind of led me into wind energy, right, to be interested. But then when I started working in civil engineering, I was concerned with water flow in natural environments, in rivers and streams and so on. And a big challenge of our generation is really climate change and the extreme flooding events that become more and more frequent. So how can we predict and prepare for the damage that these flooding events will will do to infrastructure. How can you do that when you are dealing with events that have not been ever realized, right? So perhaps you can build computer models that can do that, right? Another related example is, of course, the urban air quality, spreading of pathogens, bioterrorism attacks, and so on. Again, be able to understand the transport of scalars or chemically reacting scalars, perhaps, in complex urban environments. Going into more fundamental problems, I always, through the complex flows that I dealt with, I came across these more interesting fundamental problems that I never shied away from them. I was always curious, so I wanted to dig a little deeper. So one fundamental question was, how has hydrodynamics shaped the evolution of fish, swimming styles, the fish bodies, and so on? Why certain fish look a particular way and swim with a particular style versus others, okay? And it turns out, I'll show you some examples how simulation can make a difference. And last but not least, is really a work that I started doing at Georgia Tech when at some point I met with a biomedical engineering professor. I actually had a student in my class who was working in biomedical engineering and brought to my attention a lot of exciting problems in the cardiovascular system, which I also thought it was pretty cool to take on. And all this led to big funding areas and a lot of funding and papers and so on. So how do we go about tackling such complex problems, right? Of course, in fluid mechanics, the basic pillars of scientific inquiry is like in every other field of engineering and science. We start with theory, in this case, the fundamental equations that govern fluid flow in all these settings. I mean, perhaps more complicated forms in some flows than others, but I dealt with incompressible flow problems. These are the Navier-Stokes equations, conservation of mass, conservation of momentum, and if you're interested in energy conservation, you have to write an energy equation and so on. But these are the basic equations, so out of which you can develop theories. And then you would have to go in a laboratory setting to test the theory, right, to realize it through an experiment. So this is an image from a really cool experiment that I'll talk to you later, kind of the biggest flow experiment that has ever been done. It was in a wind turbine we built at the University of Minnesota a few years ago, where this is the turbine, and we're trying to understand how the wake of the eddies and the swirling patterns contribute in the wake. And then you develop simulation tools, right? So the idea is you can build the first principles, develop computer models that you can simulate what the flow around the wind turbine blade looks like here. And then you can validate the simulation through experiments, but these simulations provide huge insight into the flow that, A, you can use them as tools of scientific discovery. You can dig deeper. You can complement what you can learn from observation and theory and dig much deeper and get new phenomena, actually, discover new phenomena. But you can also use simulations to do virtual experiments. You can use simulation as some type of a time machine to project into the future, right? I can realize a situation that doesn't exist yet and try to use this to design or plan or whatever. And of course, more recently, the kind of the new exciting thing is the advent of AI and data-driven approaches and machine learning that now one can think of using big data from simulations, from observations, to train through machine learning engineering models, simpler engineering models that are informed by physics that can allow you to take on problems, to really use this in real-time design, okay? And the key thing, though, is that because we're interested about complex flows, we have to be able to realistically simulate all the complexities, and that's where a lot of the challenges appear. So through all this, we have this arrow. There is the key thing that kind of has been driving progress in all this is really the arrow of computing power, right, which has been growing exponentially. And the computational power today is enabling us to do things that were unimaginable a few years ago. And this is not going to stop one way or the other, whether it is quantum computing, the next paradigm or something. This is going to continue. And as I look at this, I mean, Helena talked about our age, you know, I was thinking, so it's a long time ago when I started in the early 80s at the university as undergraduate, and the first computer I worked on was a VAX 11780, right? And I was very excited working with this computer, and today my students and postdocs have been running on thousands of cores in massively parallel supercomputers. I remember some of the very first simulation that I did was a flow in a curved channel having like 800 nodes, and I thought this was pretty exciting. And now we do hundreds of millions, billions of degrees of freedom, and you know, we can do truly turbulent flows in realistic settings, as you will see. So this has been an exciting journey of computational discovery, actually, enabled by this computational power. But the important thing to realize is that even with the fastest computers today, the real flows that we are interested in are still pose a number of challenges. And this is because most flows are in nature are turbulent. And you see this is a beautiful picture, a satellite image of clouds over the Canary Islands and Madeira here, off the coast of Africa. So what you see here is a range of scales. So you see these are called the Karman vortices, big eddies. You would see the same thing behind the cylinder in a wind tunnel experiment, but you also see them at this scale. The size of these are hundreds of kilometers, right? Really big. But at the same time, you have also much, much smaller scales. That's what characterizes turbulent flows. The fact that you have eddies that in this case would range from the scale of thousands of meters to millimeters and beyond, actually, right? The bigger scale is set by the scales of the obstacles that create eddies. The smaller is set by the scale at which viscosity can act to dissipate energy. And if I create a grid, I have to have a very, very fine grid if I want to do this, resolve all the scales. So for practical flows, doing this, even with the fastest computers we have today, it's very difficult. If you look at the basic spectrum of energy in the flow, the wave number and the energy here, this is what a typical turbulent flow looks like. Large scales right here, there's a range of cascading of energy from the inertial rates from big scales to smaller scales, and the energy falls off sharply here when viscosity dissipates energy. So if you are to resolve all these scales, this is called direct numerical simulation. You have to have a grid that is very fine to resolve everything, not practical. What we do is to do what we call large eddy simulation, where we have a grid that can capture the biggest scales, and then we have models for everything that is happening in these squares, right? In a kind of a very high level of turbulence modeling today. So modeling turbulence flows is extremely important. Another issue of complexity here that we face is the geometry and the fact that we have multiple physics occurring in this flow. So we are dealing with very complicated geometries. Whether you are interested in simulating the flow in a river with woody debris, with big rocks, it's arbitrarily natural made geometries, or the flow in the heart through anatomic geometries, or the flow around the swimming fish. So we have In my group, we have spent a lot of time and done a lot of work developing new powerful computational tools. So a big part of our work has been numerical. And I'm going to use a slide just for anybody who is interested in the numerical aspects. But this has been a big part of my work, making advances in developing computational algorithms that can solve the Navier-Stokes equations in arbitrarily complex domains, in problems involving interaction of the flow with the structure, like a fish swims. Its motion is affected by the forces that the fluid imparts, but the fish generates forces. A heart flow, a heart beats, you have valves that move in response to that and so on. In rivers, you have sediments that are moving in response to the flow and so on. All these are very, very complicated problems. So we have developed a very powerful computational framework, which now is, so this is not a commercial code, this is a code that we developed from scratch in my group. And a lot of our work has been published in the Journal of Computational Physics, which is the premier journal for computational advances. But a lot of my work is also published in journals like the Journal of Fluid Mechanics, which is the premier journal for discovering new fluid mechanics phenomena through these computational tools, right? So I'm going to show you, I'm going to go through the rest of my talk some examples of how these computational tools can be used to really give insights. So I talked about fish in the first part of my title. So this is an area that we have done a lot of work. Iman Boranjani, who is now a professor at Texas A&M, was one of my most prolific students, really. And so a fundamental question there is why different fish species have been swimming the way they have. So for instance, you have different swimming modes, anguilliform swimmers. It's like eels or lampreys swim-like. They undulate a wave through their body. And you have the carangiform swimmer, which is more like a mackerel or a tuna, right? The body is stiff and only the tail moves. Distinctly different modes. Another big difference is that these guys here tend to swim at lower speeds. And by that, I mean in environments where inertia forces and viscous forces are comparable, All right, so it's the Reynolds number that dictates that. Where Karamzin for swimming takes place at a very high Reynolds number where viscous forces are not that important except a very thin layer. So the question was, is there something that determines the way fish swim that connects to the flow environment? But, you know, experimentally, you cannot take a mackerel, let's say, and make it swim like an eel at a particular Reynolds number, or an eel and make it swim like a mackerel at a particular Reynolds number. They do whatever they have evolved to do, right? So this is actually, but computationally, it's another story. You can do all kinds of things. So this was actually the cover of Journal of Experimental Biology. Through the years, I had the fortune to have my work on covers of journals many times, but this is the one that I'm most proud of because this was the first time that the Journal of Experimental Biology published a computational paper on its cover, right? And it was, so you see here the simulation of the flow around a lamprey, and these are the eddies that it creates in the wake. So what we could do with this, in a simulation setting, we can take a mackerel and make it swim like an eel, or eel and swim like a mackerel, and in fact, we can make one species race against its alter ego, right, in a flow environment. So we have a flow, it's a flow structure interaction simulation. I'm not going to show the flow here, but you introduce these two fish in the same fluid environment. This one is going to swim like an eel, and this is going to swim like a mackerel, and they're going to race each other in the same flow, all right? And then you can actually see what happens. The camera here is mounted on the slower swimmer, so you can see their speed here. So, and of course, the distances have been scaled for better visualization. You can see here at this very high, this is an environment where mackerels have evolved to swim, very high Reynolds number environment. Of course, the mackerel that swims like a mackerel wins the race in this environment, which is shouldn't be as a surprise because presumably that's why mackerel do not swim like this. But what is even more striking here, if you do the same experiment with eels. Now, eel has never swum in that environment, right? They don't know how to do this, but I can take an eel and make it swim like an eel, or an eel make it swim like a mackerel, right? And this is an exciting race. So look what happens, look what happens. So initially, this thing does better, but then look what happens when you thought the race is cold, okay? So that's pretty, and then there were many other experiments. And just so we took the same swimmers in a lower Reynolds number environment, and sure enough, there a mackerel that swam like an eel won when you reduce the Reynolds number, right? So this was the first very compelling evidence that there is a real connection between hydrodynamics and evolution. There's a lot of work we have done in this area. So I show you something really cool right now, which is kind of my more recent work with my former postdoc, Dennis Angelidis, and Alijos Ronsdag, who is a professor now at Stony Brook. Alex Tessé from MIT and Leah Mendelssohn, Alex's student, who is now a professor at Harvey Mudd. They had done these pretty cool experiments with the archer fish. So this is an experiment from Alex's lab at MIT, where you have this archer fish. This guy has evolved to be able to jump out of the water to grab prey that hangs off branches, so gets little bugs and so on. And it has the ability to generate ballistic speed. So it moves its tail to generate thrust in the water. It crosses the interface here, and then it glides to reach the air and reach to the top of its trajectory. It's able to jump several body lengths out of the water. So we actually took the experiment. They had very high fidelity videos and were able to reconstruct a virtual archer fish. So here you don't see the flow simulation. This is just the reconstructed motion, including the shrimp. I mean, that everything. So there's a little bait here. But we used the video, 3D video recording of this to come up with an anatomic model of the fish and its motion. But here we can do a lot of things. We can understand really what the flow looks like. We can understand how different body parts contribute to thrust generation in different parts. We can remove certain fins and see if the fish is able to do the same thing, right, or not. So there is a wealth of information that we can gain from these simulations. This is a simulation now that involves air, water, so it's a two-phase flow. And we can... So the experiment, we use the experimental data to reconstruct the motion of the fish, but then they have measurements. They have measurements of the flow that the fish generates in the water phase. And we could compare, actually, so this is the wake flow, and this is vorticity fields, flow rotating in a positive direction, a negative direction, and so on. The jets that are created, that this eddies is what propels the fish forward, basically, upward in this case. So we could compare, but we could do even more here. We can actually, for the first time, see what the full 3D flow looks like, which they could never see in the experiment. And so this is a photorealistic rendering, visualization of the simulations. When the fish has reached the peak of its jump, you see the 3D turbulent structures and the eddies it has created. The simulation, as I said, has the water, and you get the splash through the surface and so on. But this is kind of an indication of how complicated the three-dimensional flow is. This is something you cannot see with experiments, right? So this is a great example of how you can blend experiments. You need them to build the model. You need them to validate. But then you can get much deeper information into the flow and also get a lot more, do experiments here, because we've done a lot of work. I'm not going to have time to go over this, but removing fins, looking at how much force, thrust each particular body part produces. And there's a lot of application here in building autonomous vehicles that can exit the water and so on, inspired by biomimesis and what have you. Next example, so moving now into blood. A big part of our work there has been to focus on understanding blood flow in the heart with specific application in the area of heart valves. So we have been interested, the native aortic valve. Often there are different conditions, disease conditions that require replacement. There are different types of valves. So our work there has been to use MRI, which has been making leaps and bounds progress in terms of its resolution, build anatomic models of an individual's heart, and be able to virtually implant different heart valves, so study different conditions. The big thing there is that blood flow has an effect on cells, on blood cells, on endothelial cells. It causes them to respond. It causes disease to originate. It could cause calcification in valves. It could cause damage to blood cells and so on. So there is a very direct connection between forces induced by blood and tissue. And of course, here you have a flow structural interaction problem that makes the problem very, very complicated. So we have done a lot of work in this area, but I will show you some of our most recent work in this, in the area of bicuspid aortic valve. And I met my first someone who has bicuspid valve for the first time yesterday. I never met anybody before. So we had a great discussion. Anyway, so the normal aortic valve has three leaflets, right, that open and close in response to the flow. But about 1 to 2% of the population, mostly men, actually it's higher prevalence in men, they are born with a congenital defect where two of these leaflets are somehow conjoined together. And there are multiple different arrangements, anatomies that can be created. But you end up having just two leaflets. So have two cusps, so a bicuspid valve versus a tricuspid valve. People can live normal lives, but the problem there is that usually patients with bicuspid aortic valve are more, there's a higher prevalence of aortopathies. And a very common one, actually, is dilated aorta. So somehow this is the aorta of a normal person here. This is the aorta of actually a person with bicuspid valve. And you see this aorta keeps growing. It's like an aneurysm that at some point will burst, and that is not good, obviously, right? So one fundamental question there has been, is this genetics? Is the dilation in the aorta caused because of certain genes that are associated to the bicuspid aortic valve disease, or there is something related to the hemodynamics that one can presume would be quite different between having three leaflets versus two leaflets and so on? So we've done a lot of work in this area. So essentially, we take a patient's aorta. This is a patient-specific aorta. This is a tricuspid aortic valve, a tri-leaflet valve. And what you see here is streamlines colored with the velocity. So you see how complicated the flow comes out of the leaflets. It swirls around. You get high flow area. But look what happens when you have a bicuspid aortic valve. It's a completely different flow environment. You get a high-speed jet because of the high asymmetry that's created that is pounding one side of the aortic wall, creating much higher shear stresses here, much higher velocities. And it is likely to conclude from this that actually the hemodynamics may have a big role to play in the formation of aortopathies, like the dilation of the aortic valve. I mean, this big aneurysm that forms there. And it also, a bicuspid valve creates stenosis, aortic stenosis. So typically, you get much higher velocities, much higher level of turbulence, which is not in the physiologic range. And so the cells, the endothelial cells on the aortic wall experience a completely different environment, which suggests that hemodynamics might have a big role to play in this. So again, these are experiments that you can only do computationally. And we can compare now, because there is MRI data from a person with bicuspid aortic valve, and these are the simulations showing this impinging effect and the very high velocities and so on. So now I'm going to switch to another topic. I mean, again, these are all areas in which we've done a lot of work, published extensively and so on. But I'm just highlighting with example in it, just to give you a flavor of what is possible today with these simulations. So now I'm moving into energy field. So wind energy is a big issue of our time, right? Producing renewable electricity, it's going to happen from for the most part by wind and sun. New York is kind of a leader in setting environmental goals. By 2050, we have to eliminate our climate pollution. So we have to produce most of our electricity from renewables. We have to electrify our infrastructure, and you know everything, right? You're all working in many of these areas. So wind energy in particular is a big source of renewable energy. But the key thing there is that, okay, so you build big wind farms. The turbines now are really big, like 80 meters, 150 meters rotor diameters, and so on. It's a variable resource of energy, and primarily because of the variability in the atmosphere, the turbulence in the atmosphere creates intermittency. So you need to be able to reduce the levelized cost of energy, right, so that to make wind energy production, especially offshore, compatible to other non-renewable resources, right, and natural gas also. And in order to do that, you really have to understand how a wind farm as a system will perform, right? Because it's not really about one turbine. It's about the entire wind farm. It's not a point of optimizing how one wind farm will do, one wind turbine will do, but it's the entire system, right? So you have to be able to model complex flow phenomena with how they interact with the turbine, and you have complexities if you're near the ocean, waves, and so on. For offshore wind turbines, complex topography, complex atmospheric flow stabilities, and so on. And in fact, in a report from Department of Energy a few years ago, it was clearly identified that the largest remaining opportunities to reduce the cost of energy will come from substantial gains in understanding complex wind plan aerodynamics, right? And you can get a picture of this. This is actually a very famous picture in wind energy. This is a picture that was taken in the Horns Rev offshore wind farm, which up until recently was the largest offshore wind farm in the world. It's in Denmark and in the North Sea. Low clouds, you see the turbulence from each turbine. You see the first turbine here faces a completely different environment, right? And actually, if you look at the energy production, the first turbine always produces much higher energy, and the energy production drops off. So how you control these turbines, because they are very sophisticated control machines, how you place them relative to each other, and so on, how far apart you space them, all this is very important if you try to maximize the wind energy potential. So traditionally, how we have been trying to understand wind turbine production, energy production, and wake flows is really through wind tunnel experiments. This is an old experiment from NASA Ames, in which smoke is introduced at the tips of this two-bladed turbine. You see these big helical vortices, like as the blades rotate. This is there's a lot of information that's derived from this, that this is a very simple environment, right? That's not what happens in the atmosphere. You have a lot of turbulence in the atmosphere. You have atmospheric stability effects. You have multiple scales in the atmosphere that interact with the turbines. So this is an area we've done a lot of work, and it's where most of my recent work is really focusing. So a few years ago, while at the University of Minnesota, under the Obama administration, during the Obama administration time and the stimulus funding, we were able to get a big grant from DOE to build a utility scale wind tunnel, all right? Because, okay, you can study the small turbines in the wind tunnel, but can I do research with an actual toy, with a 2.5 megawatt turbine, 80 meters tall, 120 meters in diameter? I cannot go into somebody who is running a wind farm and say, could you let me play with some of the turbines? They kick me out because they want to make money. They don't care about science, right? So, but the thing is, we got this grant with a demonstrated vision that we're going to do something that is really cool. So do something that's very practical, but also something we can publish in Nature Communication, for instance, let's say. So my Jaron Hong is the lead person. He's a professor now at the University of Minnesota. He's a leading experimentalist. And so what the idea was, we have this turbine. How do you visualize the wake, the flow around the turbine? Well, what else do you have in Minnesota, right, as Irene knows? You have a lot of snow. And if during a snowy day you stand under a lamppost, you can actually see the snowflakes swirling around. If you take a camera and take a video of this, and then you digitally analyze that image, you can get a lot of information under the floor. So Jaron had this great idea. He finished his PhD from Hopkins, and he was one of the brightest people I hired at the University of Minnesota and for the lab that I was directing there. He said, you know, well, we can use this to do this experiment. This was the largest experiment that has ever been done in fluid mechanics. It's an area of 36 by 36 meters. It took a lot of dedication because students had to go there in February with harsh conditions, put a light here, and set this camera. So what happens is, as the turbine rotates and you get these big helical vortices that are created, right, and you cut them with a sheet of light, the footprints of these helices appear like circular areas that are devoid of snow. Why? Because there's a lot of rotation in there, and centrifugal force throws the particles, the snowflakes out. So you have, I mean, we kind of imagined that, but we couldn't really realize how good this will be. So I clearly remember that night where in 3 o'clock in the morning, I didn't go, I was the director of the lab. I wouldn't do that. But they called me. I said, you called me. And they said, you have to see these videos that we're able to get. And that was kind of the beginning of, and I don't know if you are able to see this video here, but this is the video they recorded. There was a very interesting feature here. And I'll just, if you can see these white areas here, they're not quite circles. They have these really long tails here, which we couldn't quite explain. This has never been seen before in a laboratory setting. But in the Nature paper, we came up with some made up explanation because we couldn't really understand what truly, we said it's gravity effects on the snowflakes and so on. But it was not until later when we tried to simulate this numerically, the same kind of setting with numerical simulation. This is velocity field, so velocity magnitude here. So you see the turbulence in the atmosphere, the ground here, the turbine extracts energy, so you have low momentum here in the wake, very complicated wake. But if you notice here, there are structures that appear to also have tails. And for the longest period of time, we thought that this is an artifact of the numerical simulation. And we did all kinds of tests, tried to improve our methods and refine the grids, and these things would never go away. And then one of my students said, do you remember these pictures? We published this paper in Nature, and we said this is something which has to do because of gravity. And then we took a closer look. And it turns out, so these are zooming into these images. These are the experimental images. These are the gaps in the snow, right? And you look at how complicated the structures were. We didn't have snow in the simulation, but we could use the magnitude of vorticity as a surrogate because areas of high vorticity are areas which are devoid of snow, right? So you take, this is magnitude of vorticity, instantaneous. You make black the area of very high vorticity, and you begin to see very similar shapes, actually very, very. But the simulation can add color to this because in the experiment, a void will form whether the flow rotates in the clockwise or the counterclockwise direction, right? Whether vorticity is positive or negative. In the simulation, we can see that, and to our surprise, we discovered that there are two sets of vortices here that are associated, one that rotates in the positive direction, another rotates in the negative direction. That has never been observed before. Turns out it is there in small-scale wind tunnel experiments, but they are so weak that experimentalists simply remove them from the plots, right? Because the reviewer said, you have to, this is ridiculous, well, nobody has seen this. So we did the whole thing. And we were able actually to show, when you look at the three-dimensional simulation, that there is a brand new centrifugal flow instability that occurs in the outer tip shear layer of the turbines. And so this was an exciting discovery, and it told us that we have computational tools that we can trust right now, which coupled with experiments can really provide new information about physics, okay? But then, if you really want to make a difference, okay, so this is some really cool physics, understanding phenomena and so on, but ultimately I want to have the tools to be able to optimize wind farms in this terrain, right? So very complicated terrain here. I think this is from Greece somewhere in Peloponnese, up in the mountains where a lot of turbines right now during one of my trips. But it clearly highlights, you know, the complexities of the terrain, and of course the terrain is going to impact the flow and so on. So I'll show you what we can do right now. We recently partnered with this wind energy, this developer that operates this wind farm, the Vantage Wind Farm in the state of Washington. The wind farm is located surrounded by mountains. This is LIDAR reconstructed topography. This is where the wind farm is located. Now in our models, we can incorporate the topography, we can incorporate the turbines, and we can do simulations like this. So this is just the plane at the hub height of the turbines of the particular wind farm in Washington state. Red is high speed, blue is low speed. Why there is this big difference? Because the terrain is very complicated, right? It imposes completely different, highly heterogeneous flow structures. This is very interesting because the company that developed this wind farm, they didn't have these tools at their disposal. So if you see, for instance, a very quick example, this turbine right here is able to produce quite a bit of power. This turbine, on the other hand, is producing close to nothing, because it's placed at the wrong location. But you could never know this without these computing tools, right? So this is really what we are able to do right now. We can use these tools to drive development of wind farms and so on. We have used the data from the field now to compare the power that is generated from the simulations and the experiments. The comparisons are actually quite good. And now we have a computational platform to actually go and take this on and do these types of simulations and use the tools to help the industry develop the next generation of wind farms. This is really big right now, especially because around Long Island and New York, it's going to be a huge area of development in wind farms, right? So we are working with industry right now to really develop this, to use these computational tools to have the new, all the offshore wind farms in the state of New York to be designed with the latest computational technology, really. So when you talk about offshore, you have floating turbines. So we have developed computational tools that incorporate waves with 6 degree of freedom flow structure interaction here. So this is a computational method now that has ocean waves and a floating turbine. Floating turbine design is very important because you can put them very far out. No, people don't see them. They don't get upset if they see them from the Hamptons home or whatever, right? That's a big issue. I mean, this has prevented actually development of offshore wind farm in the US. And again, we have developed tools right now. So this is a simulation where we have both waves and atmospheric wind and 6 degree of freedom interaction of a floating turbine. So you see a plane through the hub height of the turbine showing the wake structures and the waves here at the bottom. Some other cool things we can do right now is to really, for the first time, take on what I think is the holy grail, this whole concept of control co-design, right? Because so far, turbines have been designed as an individual thing, so in a sequential manner. So you want to design a turbine, you look at the aerodynamics of the blade, you look at the structural, you look at the electrical, like electronics, and then at the end, you put the control, because there is a controller to respond to the flow and maximize the energy. It has never been a framework where you can do co-design, where you design the turbine taking the controls into the loop, has never been attempted. And it was not possible because you really have to do this at these big scales. But now with the computational tools, we can actually design the turbine incorporating the possibilities to control the blades. Because for instance, you could design it and estimate that the forces that these blades will experience are X. But if you incorporate controls, it might be in reality, it's X over 10 or over 5 or over 3. It's just a small, so you can save a lot in terms of how you design and develop these turbines. So a clear example here is these turbines are, they have the basic control mode that they have is that the entire tower rotates to catch the wind basically, right? So you have this collective pitch control. I mean, rather, you can yaw the turbine, number one, and then you can actually pitch the blades. And most turbines right now, if not all turbines, have collective pitch control. So all three blades rotate in exactly the same way. But there's no reason to do this. You can do individual pitch control. So computationally now, we can, and this has never been realized before in turbines. So computationally, though, we can do that. We can incorporate collective and individual pitch control into, so we can have the controller in the simulations. And the key thing to remember here, so these are, this is a model of two turbines here. These are the bending moments on the turbine blades. The black line is a collective pitch control, but with individual pitch control, you get significant reduction of the bending moments. This has huge implications in terms of how often the blades will break, in terms of how often you have to repair them. Every time you have to repair them, not only you lose energy, you have to bring a crane that costs $150,000 a day, and you also have the cost of actually replacing. So the so-called levelized cost of energy, the amount of energy a wind farm produces over its lifetime, it goes up significantly. So the less frequency of the repairs, the better it is, obviously. So now we have the ability to do this computationally. So I'm going to move now to the last part of the example, simulations of flow in rivers. Turbulence in rivers occurs in very complicated settings. This is an example of work we had done at the University of Minnesota at a particular stream in Minnesota with trees and rocks and so on. So we have the ability now to go and create through survey the actual bathymetry of this stream with all the complexities that are encountered there. A big problem here is we want to understand how nutrients, a big issue is excessive nutrients, right, create algal blooms and so on. Turns out that if you have areas where the flow recirculates, bacteria can denitrify naturally. So you want to understand the residence times in these big streams. So we can set up this simulation, and we can do now in a simulation setting a release of a tracer. So this is a turbulent flow in this three-dimensional stream. I show you how a tracer was released and how it progresses and exits through the whole system. And we can actually, we have measurements that we did in the field, measuring concentration here and here, and we are able to do a remarkable job in terms of capturing the concentration of tracers. So you see the initial pulse right here, and then the second point right here. And of course, the agreement here is more interesting because it has the collective memory of everything that has happened. But we have the capacity now to go and do real streams, take geometry, incorporate virtual streams, do these simulations, and drive decisions in a number of things. Of course, streams have another complexity that they have sediment beds. So they actually, during flooding events, sediment beds are mobilized. So there are a lot of fundamental questions there. How do sand waves originate? Okay. How does the flow interact with sediment to create? And these sand waves actually turns out that they get very regular shapes, beautiful shapes, self-organization really, that is not exactly clear how does this happen. There have been a lot of hypotheses and assumptions, but it has never been comprehensively explained. And of course, a big question is what is their impact on infrastructure, because in rivers, sediment transport causes bank erosion, right? And mega flooding events could cause serious damage to infrastructure, could cause bridges to collapse as a result of bridge scour, right? So we have done a lot of work there. First of all, on a fundamental level, we started with a great experiment in which, this is an experiment that was done back in 2005, where you see a camera right now looking through the water. So you have a sand bed, you start the water flow, and you see the sand, the dunes develop, right? So we use this experiment because we can validate our models, and this is a very, very sophisticated model with a lot of, it has the ability to model sand and water, model the deformation of the sand dunes. So what you see here is a view of the channel from the top, so you're gonna see here the sand beds, the dunes develop, and this is a cross section right here, looking from the side, where you look at the flow. You can actually see the initially flat bed, and the dunes begin to develop, and you go from different stages when ultimately you go into a stage where you get long wavelength structures, you get dunes to merge together in very complicated patterns, and at the end of this process you look like at 6 centimeter tall mountains and lakes, you know, during phases of the history of the Earth, mega floods, actually. These are the types of processes that produced a lot of the mountains and topography that we see around us today, right? This is produced in a lab setting at smaller scale. And we did a lot of work. I don't have time to show you, but we had a lot of quantitative analysis with the experimental measurements. But you see here how they show some of these features that we also saw in the simulations. But we had a huge data set, which for the first time you could look how the turbulent flow interacts with the initially flat bed. And we were able to show that heterogeneity in turbulent fluctuations are responsible for originating the dunes and also responsible for the subsequent self-organization, actually. So there is a lot of interesting insights here. Another example is dunes come in different forms and shapes. So in desert environments where there is a bedrock and you have a finite supply of sand, you don't get these transverse dunes, but you get these Barkan dunes, these crescent moon-shaped dunes. They occur on the surface of the Earth in deserts, but also on the surface of Mars. This is a picture from Mars, actually. So the flow would come from this way, and you get these fields of dunes, and they happen underwater as well. It's not really a thing that has to do with the wind. The fundamental question there is, in rivers, there is constant supply of sediment. In a desert environment, you have bedrock, you have a finite amount of sediment, and then you end up getting these areas of bedrock exposed, right? Because somehow the flow exposes the bedrock. So I'll show you a pretty cool video. And again, this is a recent paper in which we really looked for the first time. We were able to simulate the whole process. But I'll just show you the video without getting into the details. So the blue surfaces are vorticity surfaces, so it shows simultaneously the deformation of the bed and the flow structures that this creates. And you see areas, gray areas that appear, bedrock, as you see in the satellite pictures. We had a lot of comparisons with the dimensions of these dunes as they arise from satellite pictures that our simulations agree very well. And we're able to explain very, very clearly, actually, many fundamental phenomena here through these simulations. Again, these are only possible because now we have these pretty massive supercomputers that we can take on these simulations. It was not really, I mean, when I started my career, I couldn't even imagine that I would be doing this now. 10 years ago, I could not imagine that I'd be doing this now. But you see here a dune field that you get images that look very much like the images that are observed from satellites, really big dunes, bedrock areas exposed, and so on. Lots of interesting physics there. So a lot of fundamental knowledge, but ultimately we want to take these tools now and be able to say, can I say something about the impact of mega floods, right? What a 100-year or a 500-year flooding event might mean for infrastructure, and can we plan for this right now, okay? So this is a project we started for a longest period of time at the University of Minnesota. I was talking to the Minnesota Department of Transportation, very conservative. They are comfortable with very simple engineering models. And I said, you know what? There is a wealth of information right now. We can do some really cool stuff. You have to open up a little bit and let us show you what we can do rather than using one-dimensional models based on correlations and things like that. So anyway, I convinced them to fund the project to really look at this particular bridge near Minneapolis. This is the Mississippi River right here. There's an island. They were really interested. This is a bridge that they wanted to see what happens in a 100-year, 500-year flooding event. So what we did is we used different sets of data to create a digital terrain model. We used data for the floodplain. We used data for the bathymetry. We used data for the water surface profile. We used data for the details of the bridge. We could create a digital test bed right now where we can experiment and really try to see what a 100-year flooding event and a 500-year flooding event would look like. Before we do that, we wanted to do validation for a base flow conditions, for the condition under normal situations. So this is what the simulation looks like. You have a big island here, which under normal conditions, the flow is not enough to cover it. So we went out with boats and we took measurements and we were able to really get, I mean, the measurements are not very accurate here because you have to transverse with the boat and so on. But we were able to see, along with validation that we have done in smaller channels and so on, these codes have been validated in different settings. And now we can really run, so this is what a 100-year flooding event looks like, where the island is covered, okay? And this is the bridge and the bridge pier. And you can actually look at, these are the motion of the sediments here. So high means a lot of sediment, blue means scour area, so this is where the bridge is. So you can look really at these very dynamic scour events and so on, and you can predict maximum scour. We had some historical data that agreed quite well, but we provided the computational framework that we could give now to the Minnesota DOT to plan how to protect the bridge under, because now this tool allows you to look at what bridge pier exactly will be most vulnerable. I mean, we could get a lot of information in there. And the last thing that I'll talk to you about is a really cool project, which is right here in your backyard. So this is the East River, and this is Roosevelt Island. Of course, this is Manhattan. So this is a project that actually somehow I started working on a number of years ago while at the University of Minnesota. There is a company called Verdun Power. I don't know, have you, does anybody know about Verdun Power and the Verdun Power Tidal, Roosevelt Island Tidal Energy Project is the right project. So, Verdun is kind of the leader in tidal power development, and they have identified the East River as there's significant tidal energy here, right? Of course, it goes through the Long Island Sound back and forth, very predictable. The nice thing is that the East River doesn't have any sediments, maybe some dead bodies, with, I don't know, from the mafia days, I don't know what else is in there. But really, it's an area, because if you try, in order to get license from FERC to put devices in natural waterways, you have to go through all kinds of environmental studies. And Verdun has been doing this for over 15 years. Initially, they started working with NYU to use aerodynamic codes to design these turbines, and the blades would break, because of course aerodynamics and water flow is quite different. So I was, as we were developing these tools for rivers, wind farms, this is where the two come together, right? Because now you're talking about turbines at the riverbed. So we could take the digital bathymetry of the East River, and we could install in a computer right now this tidal energy plant. So far they have gotten data, they've been able to put in there 6 turbines, and now they're in the process of actually developing the 80 turbine plant that we simulated here. So this is an example of the simulation. So this is the East River, just a plane through the flow here, but you see as we start the flow, you can see how the turbulence interacts with the blades. Of course, these types of simulations can give you very important insight in terms of how close you install the turbines, how close to the riverbanks. Very important here is what is the impact on the free surface, because navigation, this is a highly traffic area, there's bad traffic and so on. And it turns out that the East River is ideal from all these fronts, for all these sides, and we could, through the simulations, we could answer those questions. We can really look at the effect that this has on the water surface, and turns out to be minimal. This is another example of how now we can use this to do real design. And of course, we can do a lot more. As I said, this river doesn't have sediments, but there are a lot of sandy rivers in the US that it's very difficult to develop, because then you have to really show that these turbines do not impact the stability of the riverbed, right? Because there are environmental impacts if you disturb the sediments and so on. So we have the ability to simulate dunes, we have the ability to simulate turbines, so we could put all this together. And so what you see here is a turbine, the flow is coming this way, operating over a deformable bed. And as you see here, there's a big scour area, and all the sediment that is scoured from here is depositing here, and this is slowly moving. So I want to highlight this to you, this scour area, because one big question was, A, are you going to impact the stability of the river if you put many of these turbines in a sandy environment? B, is it possible that when dunes are moving during a flood, these turbines will be covered and will stop operating? So a group, and that's the coming to the end of my talk, a group of my colleagues at the University of Minnesota, we have all these cool flumes at the St. Andrew Falls Laboratory, where we could install turbines and do, this was kind of the first scale model of a full scale tidal energy plant in, well, not full, but pretty close, in a river with a sandbed. And these are all experimental work, but this experimental work inspired and be able to explain what we saw from the simulations, because these are dunes now on the bed, and you see high level, a lot of sand here, scour region. It turns out that what we found is that when the turbines were operating to extract energy, there was a peculiar self protecting mechanism. And that mechanism was the scour that you saw before. As the blades rotate and extract energy, they create very high shear stress under the blades, that as these dunes are approaching, the, the scour induced, it's keeping, the scour hole is protecting the turbine somehow. So the turbine is never covered. If you stop, if the turbines are not loaded and do not extract energy, they get buried within minutes. So this was pretty cool, and it was covered in, it was published in Nature Energy, actually, and actually made the cover of this. So I'm coming to the end right now. Hopefully, the thing that I think it's possible right now is we have this enormous power, enormous computational tools to do a range of complex flows. This can be fused together with data from different scales. These simulations could produce big data to drive machine learning models. I mean, they're expensive simulations, but you can produce data sets that you can train lower order models coupled with machine learning to really develop efficient site-specific engineering design tools. And I think that's kind of the exciting area for the future. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attention. You mean the effect on the complex terrain effect, right. the in these mountains in Washington that I showed? Yeah.
Might have been in Greece, I think there was a one with the different heights of the wind turbines that you showed. And when a wind turbine company comes, how do they set that up, or how do you get the information to know?
So I showed a simulation where we had this complex terrain and the turbines, and then we compare the power that is generated with the measurements and so on. Well, first of all, getting any kind of data out of these developers is next to impossible, okay? I worked very hard to actually, in fact, with this particular example that I showed you, I approached the company, I signed an NDA, I said, I don't want money, because I had plenty of money to do this, I wanted data to demonstrate, because it's a lot more value now that I can show what we can do. I want you to give me the data, and I'm going to sign an NDA that I'm not going to publish anything unless you say you publish, right? So we ran the simulation. We're able to show that we're actually predicting the things that they were measuring, and the data we had in this case was actually power generation. We had to make a lot of assumptions about the atmospheric conditions. There are a lot of parameters that go into building this model. We had data about the terrain. We had data about the individual turbines, how high they are, their designs, how much power they generate, and so on. So we could incorporate this into the model. And then we can compare the power output. They had instantaneous power measurements because the turbines have inside, they have a SCADA system that collects data that they possess. But they don't want to release it because they're afraid that somehow somebody else would get advantage. I don't know why, but anyway, when they saw the agreement, they were very excited, and they said, actually, that shows that we're doing pretty good. I mean, the data that we get, because they were not trusting the data ever. Now they saw that there is a simulation that agrees with the data. So they agreed that we publish. This was the first. This is the very first validation of this scale of a simulation with an industrial scale wind farm. But we have scaled the data in a peculiar way. So I didn't have time to go through this. But we group the turbines. We scale by non-dimensionalized with the output of the first group. Ultimately, you can back out a lot of the information in there. But anyway, now there's no velocity information there. We didn't have measurements about velocity fields. Now we have another wind farm that we're just completing in which we actually have velocity data inside the wind farm. We have measurements throughout the wind farm, and we can compare what the velocity profiles look like. But it's a kind of an ever-learning thing. I mean, you need data. It's very hard to get actual data in the field. But I think now it's my hope that when we show the power and what can happen, it becomes easier to get the developers to share some data. But that's why this turbine in Minnesota was very important, because this turbine we had access to all the data that we could generate. But it's one turbine, right? So we want to see in wind farms. So this example that I saw, they have some very simple engineering models that very simplistically account for the effect of one turbine to the other. As a matter of fact, in this example that I showed you, where it was pretty clear that the turbines were not optimally placed, we were able to show that When you apply the engineering model that does not account for the terrain effect, given the wind resource there, that made sense to make them like this. But their models did not have, so these tools are not yet, now they are starting to get used by industry.
They're not using into account the fact that there's a valley and a, you
know, very, very crude models. Yeah. Yeah.
See to the birds in the air.
Mm-hmm.
And when you have a situation where you really start to have massive areas with wind farm, how is it going to affect the bird population?
That has been also an issue and a lot of criticism about birds and what happens to. So it turns out all the data that they are available, they show that the effects on birds are not that significant. I mean, remember, these are huge blades. They are spaced 5 to 6 diameters apart. You're talking about 120 meters diameter. So what you see here is kilometers in size, right? A big wind farm. So there are some effects, but all the data that have been collected so far suggests that the buildings in New York City kill way many more birds. So because Trump is talking about the American Eagle, I said his tower is killing way too many more birds than all the wind turbines installed in the U.S., which are not many right now. I don't think birds is a big issue, but there were also issues with bats as well, because the bats somehow they get confused and they and in areas where there are bat populations are migrating, they part of the environmental study is that you don't develop in these areas. So in order to install a wind farm today, you have to do an environmental study. And it's pretty excruciating in the U.S. For the one turbine that we did in Minnesota, we had to go through unbelievable level of scrutiny for just one turbine in this area, which is completely isolated, soybean field, Rosemount Park. Tell you a quick story. There's nothing there, just soybean fields. The University of Minnesota owns this big plot of land there. And right across the highway where the turbine is, there was a big farm where back in the 1950s, they developed a historic method for milking cows. Okay, so we have all this $5.5 million project to build this turbine. We've done everything. The History Society of Minnesota says the turbine is going to impact the view from the farm, so the historian of the future will not understand, will not know fully what the farmer saw to get inspired. I'm not making this up. And they said, you have to address this. And now suddenly I have to go to DOE, everything is ready. How do we do this? So we had to hire a consultant for $10,000 to take black and white pictures of before and after, to put them in the history archives. Okay, so this, but that's a true story.
Mm-hmm.
So that, yeah.
And so the problem becomes if you choose a lattice, there'll be days when it's optimal and days where it's suboptimal.
Right.
In the physics literature, there's something that's come up recently called hyperuniformity, which makes distributions essentially random on short length scales and uniform on long length.
Really?
No.
Again, the spacing of wind farms right now, traditionally most wind farms is one after the other. Actually, there is a lot to be said about staggered arrangements because it takes account into a lot of this variability.
This is a little bit more sophisticated than even staggered.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying, but I can tell you no. I mean, there is also work we have done that looks like having towers of different heights might maximize because you can catch wind at different areas and you can also modulate the flow for at higher levels with. So there's a lot of possibilities for optimization right now. Now with the computational tools that we have, we can really try to do this. And I think what I've been telling, and I think I've had some success now to a lot of the industry players here that are coming to New York to develop turbines, is that we can, for the first time, we can develop these wind farms. There is nothing there. If you build them, it's very difficult to change them, right? Because these projects are there for 20, 30 years. Each one costs several $1 million. It's a huge investment. But now we can actually do this. But you're right, I'm going to look into that because we're trying to look at optimization tools right now. of how you, what is the optimal arrangement? Because the points you mentioned are very, it's exactly right on.
By the way, there's a wind turbine being built in Rotterdam right now, mm-hmm. where the individual blades will be 110 meters.
Yeah.
So they're
getting really big. It's 100, I mean, there's 15 megawatt turbines right now that are being built. This is huge. This is huge. Yeah, this is amazing. And the thing is, it's interesting because the higher you go into the atmosphere, the intermittency, the less it becomes, right? Because the more you are able to catch wind from higher levels. So the and also, as you cover the whole, so the whole U.S. with turbines, let's say, the intermittency issue becomes less. Because you homogenize. I mean, the wind may not blow that high in one area, but it's likely to be high. So it's, yeah. Yeah, you had that.
My questions have been really support. Fascinating talk. And every single one of them, I was thinking my questions. You mentioned in the beginning that your code was, I assume you're not using the same code, but incompressible. Mm-hmm. And in all the examples, I can see that's applicable, but I'm looking at the sediment problem. How does it model that? Is it non-Newtonian?
So in the sediment, there is a two-phase flow capability in the code. So in the sediment, basically, so if you look at how sediment is transported in nature, there are two distinct modes. First of all, you have sediment particles that stay in close proximity to the bed and sort of saltate, kind of jump, but they stay within thin. Right. But then there are sediments that comes into suspension and forms this cloudy kind of suspension that is transported by the flow. It will be deposited somewhere later, so the model has the capacity for both. The flow is still incompressible, but it is for a dilute suspension, and the bed, you solve a macroscopic equation that gives you the evolution of the bed shape in response to the instantaneous shear stress that the flow exerts. And also, you have different correlations that are based on experimental measurements and at the rate at which sediment is going to be suspended. So the model has all these capabilities in there. But the suspensions are too dilute to go into, it's still Newtonian. There's no. I think, these approaches can be used for simpler, more fundamental flows, but when it comes to really complex flows like this, yeah, it's through simulation that you can. But you can use these tools to really analyze and extract information and develop, there is a lot of mathematics, yeah, to develop reduced order models. Because the holy grail, I think, here, this, so if I want to do an optimization of a wind farm, these simulations are massive, right? They take few weeks to complete each one of them, right? But you get enormous amount of information. So in an optimization loop, you can't do that. But what you can do is use the data through advanced, through model reduction techniques to develop reduced order models. But have reduced order models that are site specific and physics informed. So you could incorporate machine learning in that as well. And a lot of work in fluids right now is physics-driven machine learning. So rather than searching through a neural net randomly, you know that it has to satisfy the Navier-Stokes. So you could use that constraint. There's a lot of work coming out of Brown, actually. My colleague and friend, George Kriniadakis, there. He's doing some really cutting-edge work now to show that actually you can use, if you incorporate the Navier-Stokes in a deep learning framework, you can much quicker. Is that right? Okay.
This was the thing. Models that you use that to collect data and you iterate.
Yeah.
And when machine learning came, it was such an incredible tool, which, by the way, it started years ago.
I know.
And so we kept on saying, use the modeling or a priori physical information to be able to reduce the space of the things, and then you can iterate. And then the company started coming recently saying, we want to do
That's right. The names change, right? But
for your work on the bicuspid valve in the heart, has it led to any knowledge for the medical industry to alter how they treat the condition?
Not that I'm aware of. actually. But I think, so a lot of the work that we have done in prosthetic heart valves, it's been used right now to try to design, do site-specific design of heart valves. But for the bicuspid valve, I think this is more of a fundamental study that has given insight. I don't know what it might suggest there for a bicuspid valve. It's pretty cool because there has been a big question of whether it's hemodynamics or genetics, and I think this simulation showed that hemodynamics has a lot to do. It might suggest that an early intervention might help, because this happens over time, right? If you keep your aorta getting pounded by this high-speed jet in one side at very high shear stresses and a lot of turbulence, that so maybe you want to intervene earlier and have a replacement there and so on. But this work has not made its way into the clinical practice right now. Yeah.
Okay, let's take a moment to thank
you.